if you go away, what will I do then? How will I ever love again? And if I lose you now, I'll find you anyway. I'll need you every day of my life. From now on, you are the air that I breathe. You're the reason I live. After you, the sun will drown its fire in the sea. And after me, all the rivers will run home. When the world is gone, I still won't let you go. Now I know what love is. It goes on eternally after.
Good morning. I'm Phil Sweeney, Ralph's brother-in-law. I'm married to Joy, Janet's sister, and that's how Ralph and my relationship started. But Ralph's personality, his sense of humor, and his kindness turned that relationship into a friendship. I am honored to represent the family in welcoming you today to celebrate the life of Ralph Backstrom. Janet, Marty, Roberto, Dee Dee, Andrew, and the family want you all to know how much we appreciate y'all being here to celebrate Ralph's life. And what a life Ralph had. From the frozen ponds of Kirkland Lake to becoming number six for the Montreal Canadiens, to coaching, to having his name on the Lord Stanley Cup six times, to coaching the Denver Pioneer hockey team to the Frozen Four, to becoming the founder of Janet and his beloved Colorado Eagles, he had a full and productive life. But all those truly amazing accomplishments are what Ralph did. All of you in the room today know who Ralph was. We're going to hear from Ralph's children and their special memories of their dad. And any or all of you who would like to share your memories with Ralph, we're going to hear those today too. Again, thank you for being here. May we pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for putting Ralph into our lives. Thank you for the many blessings that were bestowed on him and us through our relationship with Ralph and with you. Thank you for sending your son to be a living example to us and to die on the cross for our sins. Thank you for the promise of eternal life and the assurance of being adopted into the family of that eternal life. Continue to strengthen and comfort Janet, Marty, Roberto, Dee Dee, Andrew, and all the family and friends as we go through the heartbreak and the sadness of our separation from Ralph in this world. Help us to remember and live in the assurance that Ralph is free of pain and is in the glory of your amazing grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm Marty Backstrom, Martin Backstrom, Ralph's elder son, and it's wonderful to hear these tributes to my father. I'm looking forward to hearing the tributes here, but after he died in February, it was amazing to read the articles from around the world. I saw them on the internet. They were written in Swedish, Finnish, French, Estonian, Hungarian. I even found one in Chinese. It was quite amazing. Much has been said about his career, but maybe less about the personal and family side over his 83 years. And I think it's safe to say that I've probably known him longer than anyone in this room, and longer than many people listening in over the streaming. Not all, but most. So I thought I'd pass along a few thoughts. He died, actually, just a month after my 59th birthday, so 59 years. My father was fundamentally kind. I think everyone has pointed that out. He had a very good heart. We all knew this, and it was evident from early on. He revealed his kindness over the years, I think first to his own parents while he was growing up in Northern Ontario. My grandparents, his parents, Esther and Alban Backstrom, were excellent people. They were Swedish-speaking immigrants from Finland who endured a very hard life with little opportunity. And my father might have followed in their footsteps had it not been for his talent, which lifted him and them to some extent out of straitened circumstances. And of course, hockey, even though I'm not going to speak about hockey much, it really animates everything about his life because it enabled him to achieve much, and also it helped everyone around him. My grandfather was a miner, and my grandmother, Esther, a janitor for the local school district. Ralph remained devoted to them even while in the spotlight. I'm told, for instance, that even as my father was starting his hockey career in the late 50s, he would stop by to help his mother finish cleaning the big schools where she would work until late. For years, she cooked on a wood stove, a simple wood stove, which is a hassle in a place like Kirkland Lake where it's snowy all the time. But in the late 50s, while still barely making a salary, he bought her a fancy new one, a not wooden stove, and she enjoyed that for many years. He also ran a couple of their cars into the ground in the 50s. But as soon as he could, he bought his father a new one, and then a new one after that, and a new one after that. And I remember riding in them in the 1960s. I also remember a very important episode. My father had been traded to the LA Kings, and he invited his parents to come to Los Angeles. It was a very long trip from Northern Ontario. This was in the early 70s. My grandmother pointed out they came on the Jumbo Jet. This is how I remember that. It was a famous line. But he brought them to a very fancy Beverly Hills dentist, another example of his kindness, and had all new teeth put in their mouths. And that was a big deal because they were so poor. They had gotten their dentures from the Sears catalog or worse. We don't know. And you know, he really did. He really did look after them until his last, till they died. And of course, he and Janet made multiple trips up to Canada in the 80s. And I remember how upset my father was when his father died in 1983, and then again his mother died in 1996, and very 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 upset. And so he was a good son. He was devoted as well to his cousins, who he mentioned his cousin as he was in his last day. He was dreaming about fishing with his cousin Glennie. So very important family. As for our own immediate family, my parents married in 1961 when they were both very young. My mother Frances was only 19 and my father was just 23, and I was born when Ralph had just a little after he turned 24. By then, he was a big star for the Canadians, Les Canadiens de Montréal, which meant an all-consuming life of travel, interviews, games, public events, weeks on the road, city to city by overnight train. In those days, they did not fly. They would play a hockey game, and then at midnight, they'd get on a train for Chicago. And they'd arrive in Chicago the next day, just before the game, and they'd have to have a police escort to the arena because there was so little time. And even when he was home, it was naps during the day before the game and a steak and a baked potato in the afternoon, and he would be gone by 5. And then I remember being woken up at midnight with Chinese food, and that happened after every game. And I think that's why I like Chinese food. But, you know, family life during those years was perhaps similar to that of military families, with the father gone for long, long periods. And I think it was very hard on both the father and the mother. But gradually, though, with the hockey union and league expansion and air travel, things got much better. And I was able to get to know my father better. He was always an excellent provider, and over the years we became closer and closer, especially after I became an adult. I left for college at age 18 and found my own feet. He was always very welcoming to my spouse, Roberto, these past 25 years, and his kindness became ever more evident over the decades. It was truly, truly something to watch and a note. Over the last several years of my father's life, we would speak by phone regularly. In fact, it was every Sunday at 9 a.m. sharp, with me in California and my father here in Colorado, and Janet said he would wait for the calls. I would also stay with him here in Colorado for many weeks to give Janet a break from caretaking, because as all of you know, he did have a very serious case of dementia. And during those times when I stayed with him, we would have many wonderful conversations, insightful conversations, and they were really amazing, probably the best conversations we've ever had. And it was an irony, since he was ill, but very, very nice. After he fell ill in January and then went into home hospice care, Janet told him to hang in there, his children are coming. And in fact, I learned in the car this morning that on Tuesday, the Tuesday before he died, he had said, "Janet, I'm ready to go home." But Janet said, "No, hang in there, because your kids are coming, and you can't go till they come." Roberto and I were the last to arrive on a Thursday, and he hadn't left the bed for several days, I think since Sunday. But when we arrived, and this is, I think, an example of his kindness and his devotion, when we arrived after being in bed for days, he actually asked to get out of bed, and he got into a chair with some help, and he even asked for a beer, which is very typical. I remember that growing up. And he stayed in the chair for about 20 minutes, and he seemed to be enjoying being part of the group. But after 20 minutes or so, it made it clear that it was too much, and we had to put him back to bed. And that was the last time, actually. He never woke up again, and he died several days later. And you know, I think my father was always a fine person and a fine family man, but I think over time, he became finer and finer. And I think all of the credit, needs to go to his wife, Janet, who recognized and cultivated these qualities. And we have Janet to thank for the devotion and the service that she displayed for many years. And so I'd like to say on behalf of the family, the extended family, and I'm talking about the cousins, my father's cousins in Finland, who you may have seen on the scroll, his friends in Kirkland Lake, his many, many friends from the hockey days, many of whom are still around, family friends, on behalf of my mother, who's very concerned, and all of their friends from the old days, some of whom are listening in, to say thank you, Janet. You know, it's amazing what she did for the last several years, and we're in your debt. So thank you. And I'd like to say once again to everyone, thank you for coming and for joining us on the internet. And I look forward to hearing your comments later in the program. Thanks.
Thank you, Martin. That was lovely. And thank you to everybody who's here. We appreciate it. And to everybody who's listening, don't make me cry. I think maybe in 5 or 6 countries. So I've had a long time to think about what I was going to say today. And I've gone all over the place. And I wonder, why are we here? Not here today, but why are we here living? Maybe to learn from people, to experience, to grow. I was with my dad when he took his last breath. It's a privilege, I guess. Our breath, that's our life force, our prana. And, you know, I think that's what the great religions and the great philosophers of the world have attempted to explain to us, why we're here and why we leave. And it's a fate that we will all share. We will all be leaving one day. So, Alzheimer's was a long goodbye, and at the end, his life became more simple, and we could just sit and enjoy a bowl of ice cream or lemon meringue pie, his two favorites, and just have a simple conversation, and sometimes just sit there in silence and do nothing. So Ralph was born a humble man, and he died a humble man, and in the interim, he obviously achieved a lot of dazzling things. He was defined by hockey, but it wasn't the only thing that defined him. A lot of you don't know this, but he was a top-ranked tennis player and extremely competitive. His knees unfortunately ended his tennis career, but he wanted to keep going, and he became famous for broken rackets in the style of John McEnroe. Imagine that. Ba-doom. In his heart, he was Benjamin Franklin, and he was an inventor. And he was always tinkering and inventing. One of his notable accomplishments were the predecessor to his street skates, which became rollerblades. And they were called Ralph Backstrom street skates. And when I was a child, he used to skate up and down the street in the summers, and everyone would come out of their homes and go, look at that crazy hockey player. And he'd be up skating up and down the streets. He also tried to patent a stinkless toilet seat. A stinkless toilet seat. It had a little fan. That was a crappy idea. Who was he? He was into accountability. He did not believe in bailouts. He did not believe in handouts. If you wanted something, you had to earn it on your own, which was a painful lesson for a 22-year-old graduating from college with a negative net worth. But he was very modest, and that blue-collar upbringing never left him at all. He was very loyal to his childhood friends, of course. As my brother said, one of the last things he said to me was that he was going to go fishing with Glennie when his eyes were closed, and said, go on, you can fish all you want. He loved fishing. He loved the Canadian forest. He liked simple food, meat and potatoes. And the current state of professional athletes did confuse him a bit because they were so affluent. And he used to always say to me, if I were playing today, I'd be making millions. And he probably would have. Mostly, he was an honest, decent man, extremely proud of his heritage from the Swede-Finn Canadian heritage. He took his last breath right before the Super Bowl was starting. And one of the things he said to me, that he wanted to go shoot pucks at Tom Brady. But he's not gone. I dream about him. And we have these conversations when I'm dreaming. And conversations we couldn't have when he was alive. And he has a message for everybody. And that message is, you never die. Thank you.
Well, I am the youngest son, Andrew. Met probably most of you at one point or another. Talking about my dad, like, what would he want me to say? He'd probably say something like, rub, dub, dub, bring on the grub. Literally. Let's go have a beer, you know, let's get on with it. But anyway, the word that came to mind for me is salt of the earth. Because he was the salt of the earth. He was never above anybody. He was just down to earth as they get. He never had a fancy car. Janet said he always wanted a Cadillac. He never got the Cadillac, unfortunately. But that wasn't him. I mean, it was, but it was. He wanted a Cadillac. He never got one. Despite all his accomplishments, he had no ego whatsoever. He never put himself above anybody, ever. I mean, he was just so normal and so blue-collar in many ways. There could have been a book written about him, and maybe there will be someday. And there's, you know, but he probably wouldn't want a book written about him, because I'm just a guy. I'm not anyone special. One memory that comes to mind, I don't know why this comes to mind, but I was down in the DU locker room before a game, and the trainer was having a, you know, hard time. He's bundling some sticks and stuff like that, getting equipment ready. He's like, want some coffee? I'll get you some coffee. And the head coach is going to get the equipment manager some coffee. That's just how he was, you know. Just as simple as it gets, and he was never above anybody. And for whatever reason, that memory stuck with me. And when I was trying to think about what to say, if you're driving a car with him, he'd always get in the back seat. I'll get in the back seat. No, Dad, you sit in the front. No, I'll get in the back. As simple as that, that kind of sums up his personality in a lot of ways. His selflessness, his conscious about other people felt. He was very aware of feelings of people. Very, you know, very conscious of that. One, you know, I'm on some Facebook groups with the NHL and the WHA and, you know, past acquaintances, et cetera. One theme that seems to come up over and over and over is how classy he was. One guy said, your dad oozed class. He was just, there was no finer. He'd always stop, and when I was a kid, he stopped and gave me an autograph. He stopped and talked to my mom. He used to go visit cancer patients in Montreal at the hospitals. Him and John Ferguson, for one instance, did that. I hope Pete Demers, the trainer from LA Kings, doesn't mind, but I'm going to quote him. He said, your dad was the classiest player to ever walk in the doors of the LA Kings locker room. He represented our game in a first-class way. Truly a first-class gentleman. Pete also said he always dressed to the T. And back in those days, from what I understand, the LA Kings were, you know, they weren't the polished Montreal Canadiens, but he kind of taught a lot of those guys a little bit how to be classy and step up your game as a professional, not just a player, but as a professional person all the way around. So another story I heard from somebody online, there was a game in 1972 versus LA Kings versus Boston Bruins, and he scored 2 goals in 6 seconds. I think it's the LA Kings record, if I'm not mistaken. And the person who was watching this in the stands told me that it looked like it was an intentional hit on him. So I'm not going to name the player who did it, but he took 5 stitches to the forehead right after that. And he was the star of the game, so they interviewed him at the end of the game. And the interviewer said, what was that all about? He goes, was that intentional or something to that nature? And my dad said, no, he's too good a guy. He's too good of a player. He would have never done that. So maybe it was intentional, maybe it wasn't, but he did not want anyone to think it was intentional because he knew how to take a hit and be a professional. So, speaking of the Eagles, Carl Eagles, he was extremely proud of what you all built up here. He was proud of the fans. He loved the fans. He always talked about the fans, and it's evident when you walked around the corridors and you saw him talking to everybody. They all came, hey, Ralph, how you doing? Hey, Ralph. And, you know, he's just one of the guys. You know, he's not the superstar standout hockey player that he was. He was one of the guys, one of the people, one of the regulars, you know. And, you know, he was just that. That's just how he was. He loved Water Valley, too. He'd always brag about Water Valley. He loved the geese, loved watching the pelicans. Come out here. There's 100 geese flying over. Check this out. You know, that was him. He loved that. And above, you know, in my mind, he was always a dad to his last days, to his last breath. I was also there with my brother and sister for his last breath. And as hard as that was, as excruciating as that was the, had to be there. And it was traumatic, but I'm so happy I was there. If I wasn't there, that'd be very difficult to deal with, you know. So, and he was just a dad to the end. Every time you call him, everything okay? Always you first, never him, you know. He knew he was in a bad state. And he told me one time, this is a real lousy point in my life, but how are you doing? Everything okay? How's the job? Always concerned how I was doing, you know, when I talked to him on the phone 2 to 3 days every week. In his final moments, I thanked him for all the decency he taught me, for all the big lessons, the little lessons. One thing he used to say a lot, life is a cinch by the inch, it's hard by the yard. And that's kind of how I've lived my life. And that's how he lived his life. He had all kinds of little one-liners like that that would, you know, you'd think of sometimes when you're going through a tough time. I remember what Dad said, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Let's apply that right now. So his character was bigger than life in a lot of ways, but also humble as it gets and modest as it gets. So, Janet, thank you. We love you. Everything you went through, it's amazing. We're indebted to you forever. You made his last days so comfortable. And it's tough, you know, what you went through. But you brought him home. He didn't have to go somewhere in some strange place. And he was there with us to the end, at home, with the TV on, the Super Bowl coming on. And I do remember that, and he passed away right before the Super Bowl. And I don't think he did want to see Tom Brady win another one, but. that being said, I'm a musician, and he was always extremely supportive of that. He'd come out to LA and watch us play some gigs, and he loved it. He'd come watch us rehearse sometimes, and we were rehearsing one time, and we were doing a Waylon Jennings song. He goes, oh yeah, I met Waylon up in Montreal, we had played cards all night. Like, why didn't you ever tell me this? Huge, huge Waylon Jennings fan. You're like, why did you not tell me this? Why? Because, well, he had a million stories like that. But you had to ask him. They didn't flow out. Because he doesn't brag. He's like, oh, you know, I'm just a guy. You know, I'm just a normal dude. So anyway, my friends and I wrote a song. It's been recorded through 3 or 4 different living rooms. You'll actually hear my ring doorbell probably. So, you know, we recorded and mastered it ourselves. I did all the guitar, most of the guitar. And the person on drums is a former Atlantic recording artist, a friend of mine, Paul. And I got to thank him if he's watching this because he put a lot of time in. And it's an instrumental. It's not a vocal song. But it was the last song my dad heard. And it wasn't done when he heard it. So this is the finished product. And I hope he's listening. I hope he's listening. Thank you all. Thank you.
Andrew, that was wonderful. Well, I wasn't going to tell a story about me and Ralph, but I've decided to do so. We was at the Mirage. I think it was Janet's birthday. Me and Judy and Joy and Janet and me and Ralph. They were in the pool, and me and Ralph was sitting at the poolside bar watching a football game. So I asked the bartender, I said, "Where's the nearest restroom?" He said, "Well, there's one all the way across the pool, but if you want to pay $25, you can go into one in Bear, which is the European pool topless." He said, "I think Britney Spears is in there today." Ralph turned to me and said, "Man, this beer's running right through me too, Phil." By the way, we didn't spend the $25, but that's just the way Ralph was. So. Rick and Wendy Kozaback couldn't be here today, but they asked us to read his memories of Ralph. "I'll be forever grateful to Ralph for taking me on as his assistant with the Phoenix Roadrunners in 1991. We had worked together before while he was at Denver University, and I was coaching Penticton Knights in BC. Joining him in Phoenix started a most wonderful relationship for the two of us and our wives. With the opportunity Ralph gave me, it opened a door for us that we will forever be grateful. While in Phoenix, we began planning and began implementing the Roller Hockey International League. Then our ventures with the Western Professional and Central Hockey Leagues. I'll never forget our many trips through Texas, the lower than low budget hotels we camped out in, and the fabulous stories we shared. Through all our travels and certainly bumps along the way, all RB wanted was the first right of refusal on a franchise if we could make one happen in Colorado. Thankfully, he was able to deliver on his wish. Our annual hockey school in Battle Creek was another wonderful time for both of us and the many staff and coaches we brought along to help us. A great opportunity, thanks to Ralph. He was so well respected by all of our gang. Through our nearly 40-year hockey relationship, I consider Ralph to be my dearest friend, colleague, and confidant. He gave me an opportunity, mentored me along the way, joked with me, and stuck by me through so many issues. I will never forget him. It pains me to not be there with all of you to share in the celebration of a life well lived and with so many fond memories." I want to now welcome anybody that would like to tell their memories of Ralph. Chris, would you start us, please?
Well, good morning, ladies, gentlemen, and best friends of Ralph. I know there's a lot of here that are best friends of Ralph. He was that kind of guy. You get around him and you wanted to be his best friend. He's just a nice man, a man that meant a lot to me, meant a lot to a lot of people. But he was always somebody you'd like to have as a best friend, that's for sure. But again, welcome. I can remember I had some time on my hands last week and decided I'd take a tour from the house to here just to see the timing and get the warden to come out with me so she was not going stir crazy. And we kind of timed it as we were going along, and I said, "Wow, isn't that pretty over there? And it's on this side, the cemetery's beautiful here, and the graveyard, and absolutely fabulous. I mean, this is what a beautiful area. I know if Ralph was here right now, he'd be saying how pretty it is and how fantastic a business must be around here and how they must survive so well." And I thought, yeah, and how would he finish that off? Oh, they're all trying to die to get in here, that's how. But he always had those one-liners, and I botched that one. But his one-liners were to keep. They were precious to me. He was a very funny man. Oftentimes he had me in tears when I shouldn't have been, but you know, he had this habit, not as a habit, a good thing, a real good thing. And that was when he did the autographs on a t-shirt, a jersey, a hat, a spare tire, I don't give a rat what it was. He would sign it the same way all the time. And I'd be going squirrely. I would see this lineup that Gavin had prepared, and it was 1,500 people long and so on. I'm, oh my God, I'm dead serious. Long, long lineups. And it wasn't for me, it was for Ralph. And as people came up, and you imagine the number of letters in Ralph Backstrom, he would, Ralph. Back. Strum. Did you like that? Yeah. So it was like that every single time, and I'd be yarding on his jacket. Come on, man. I want a beer. Let's get out of here a little quicker. He goes, no. Just like everybody had said, and Andrew really emphasized this, he was just another guy, and he wanted to make sure that if you were waiting to get a signature from him, it was going to be spot on, A1, first class, Ralph Backstrom signature, and he was not going to make a mistake. It was valuable. What are they at right now, Andrew? About $6 a card or something? Yeah. So, I mean, but really, he did that with pleasure in his heart, pride in his soul, and caring about the other person, and not thinking that it was just something I could unload on. I got to do this right for every single guy. And he did that. He did do that. He was amazing. I got to know Ralph over 20 years of this hockey stuff. I knew him a little bit before when he was scouting, and there's some stories I could go into there that might be a little off color, so I'll leave that alone. But getting to know Ralph, and especially Janet, and how they worked things out together was really quite cool. They had a very, very good relationship, a very strong one, but unique, without a doubt. I can say it was unique. I remember walking in one time and hey, Ralph, what's going on? Let's go grab a beer. And Janet would say, just a minute, I'll be right back. Ran out of the room, went to the bathroom, ran back, and she had a tie on her head at the time because she'd lost all her hair. She was, fourth level in the cancer that she had. But she had to come back and give me a hug before I left and wish Ralph well. That's just the way she was, and she was tough, and man, she hung in there. When we got into a spot with Ralph and he had to go to the hospital, he was very, very sick. On the other side of the coin now, Ralph got into it where he was so sick that he'd spent close to a week in the hospital, and the nurses told us one morning, and I think Janet was there as well, when he decided that he was gonna have a party, and all the tubes that they had plugged into him at the hospital were thrown away, and somebody dialed up the morphine too high, and he was just having a gas, and he was gonna go to a party. And it was back to when he was with the junior team or something like that, and the nurses couldn't control him. Oh, it was really quite funny. Once we got him, they got him nailed back down onto the bed, and he was kind of secured and everything else. A needle had to be inserted into Ralph, and where the needle was going was something to do with the gallbladder or whatever it was, I'm not quite sure. But the nurse came up and said, listen, this needle has to go into a kind of a dangerous area, and I don't want to pierce one of your lungs. That wouldn't be very good. And she was very stern and serious about this. And Ralph kind of looked around and said, well, I got two of them. What's the big deal? And it's just things like that where it just, it carried on like that so many times. It was just the way he addressed things. Another one of his famous ones I'll leave you with, it was inevitably, as we talked about his career to people in a bar or ladies and gents that were out having a few drinks, and we'd explain, well, Ralph played for the Montreal Canadiens. They kind of knew who that was. Well, Montreal's in Quebec. Quebec's a French-speaking province. So they go, well, naturally they'd ask, Ralph, can you speak French? He goes, no, but I can kiss it. All the time. All the time. I probably seen more, life in the last 20 years here in Colorado than anywhere that I've been over my travels in the hockey world and so on, and taking my family of four from godforsaken Edmonton, Alberta, all the way out here and down to San Antonio, Texas, and so on. But I've seen a lot of life out here, and a lot of great things. You know, children that now have my grandchildren, friends that I've made here that are just terrific, fantastic people. And just overall, I say to you, the best friends of Ralph, which we all are, we're missing that man, and I can't take away those tears. I can't take away those tears. But I can tell you, remember, just remember, and that'll make it better. Then you'll smile again. That's the only way to do it. That's how you get rid of those tears. Just remember the good things. Thanks for coming today. I really appreciate it, and never want to get too serious. Ralph didn't like that, so. Happy days. Let's have a good one. Thank you.
So anybody else serve it up?
Well, I wasn't prepared for this, but yeah, I got to do it, right? Yeah. First day I met Ralph, Jerry Helgeson brought him over to my office because Ralph said, I want to get this deal going with this thing called the hockey team, a little legal thing, and I didn't know anything about it, really didn't know much about hockey at the time. Luckily, I still don't. So Ralph comes over to my office, and my office happens to be on a lake, and he walks in, doesn't pay attention to anything or anything. He just goes, this reminds me of home, reminds me of Kirkland Lake. I'm gonna go get Janet, we're moving here. And that's how he made that decision. Like Janet, like you had a say? You were moving. But it was fun because Ralph was probably, no not was, is the most humble, amazing gentleman that. So this is kind of funny because I'm the biggest baby in the world when it comes to this. But once I get over it, I can get on a roll and then I'll get you giggling. But Ralph was the gentleman of my life. You know, he just never, ever didn't do anything but class. And he was so fun to be around, and you could get that deep chuckle out of him by throwing a joke right at the right time. But Ralph was so humble that had it not been for other people telling me about this and Six Stanley Cup stuff, I would have never known. Not in 20 years of knowing him, I would have never known. And that's Ralph. He was... an honor to be around. Some of the best people in my life are because of Ralph. He was just to the very end, even my last day, Vicky and I got to see him, just pure class. Said he loved us. We got to share a little bit of, just a little tiny bit of sugar between us, and then we left the family alone. But he's just literally, I wear a tie almost never, but for this gentleman, Vicky gets up this morning, she goes, you're wearing a tie? I go, for RB? Yep. And so just some real quick stories. One of the kind of fun ones is whenever you were in the office with Ralph, Ryan Bach, or Rick Baker, and all three of them together, They'd walk in and say, hey, RB, hey, RB, hey, RB. It was always something funny with Ralph about that. But Ralph, a couple quick stories. I'm going to get the details wrong, but the gist of it is right. Ralph had nasal surgery, sinus surgery one time. And he's telling me about it. And this is probably 10 years ago, maybe. And he's filling out the thing for the x-ray technician. And he's telling me this. Did you ever have your nose broke? No. Did you ever have pneumonia? No. No. So he gets his x-ray, and the tech comes back and said, Ralph, your nose has been broken 14 times. What is wrong? Why would you? He goes, oh, I just thought them were bloody noses. Whoop, didn't know. But that's a testimony to how tough and what a great guy he was. One of the quick stories, and I'll try to be brief on this, but Ralph was bragging about Kirkland Lake, right? And told me a lot of stories about Kirkland Lake, and mom and dad, his dad was a gold miner, and he told me that when the Canadian recruiter came up to recruit him, and I think he was 16 or 17 years old, he laid five $100 bills down, and in Canada, an American $100 bill is a big deal. And all he could think about, in true fashion of Ralph, was, he said, all I could think was my dad going 8,000 miles or 8,000 feet a day down into a coal mine for less money than that a year. So he grabbed the money, signed the deal, and gave it to his dad. That's Ralph. So he's just always thinking about somebody else. But into that fashion, he was also always bragging about, okay, I'm done crying out. He's always bragging about Kirkland Lake and the moose. There's just moose everywhere. Martin, you can't even walk down the street. There's moose. So we line up a trip. And I don't know if anybody here has ever tried to get a gun into Canada, but we had five people, and I took Leonard Weiss and my boys. We took Jed up to Kirkland Lake, and we're going to go moose hunting. And he's got a buddy, Bill. Bill the Eskimo Bill, he called him. And he's my moose guide, right? So we go up there for a week, and no word of a lie, like the Canadians say. I stood on a stump in a swamp about this big round with Eskimo Bill sitting next to me blowing on a moose horn. Stood there for probably 4 to 5 days, 10 to 12 hours a day eating my lunch, and never saw even a raccoon, right? No, not, and neither did Austin or Tyler or Leonard. And Leonard bitched so bad, oh my God. So. It's getting a little frustrating, and to their credit, it was pretty warm season there, and it was just not right for moose. But what gave me confidence is I got in this old junky truck with Eskimo Bill every day to go 15 miles up this hill, and the back of his truck was just filled with moose legs, like from the joint down. There's 50 of them in there. It was like really gross, and so I had this confidence that my moose guide was like the guy. So we're going around, and when you go to Kirkland Lake, there's a town just down the road, Timmins, I think. And there's a mountain of black that you can see for 100 miles. It's a giant mountain. And when you go into Timmins, it has a great big billboard that says, Home of Shania Twain. So don't think anything about it. I think we landed at Timmins. We drove over to Kirkland Lake, never gave it another thought. And when we were up there, gold mining was in a tank, and it was pretty desolate economy up there at the time. So after about 4 days of absolutely nothing on the moose hunt, Ralph's kind of feeling bad and Bill's feeling bad, and I'm saying, so Bill, we're driving out dark in the morning. He goes, you know, I'm not supposed to do this, but I know where the moose are. I'm gonna sneak you over there. It's private property, but the company's bankrupt and everything's locked down. They'll never find us. So we drive to that mountain. It's a mountain like Long's Peak, but it's a man-made mountain. It's black, looks like coal. And we're up there, and me and Bill are tracing all over this mountain, and we're looking for moose. And again, never saw a squirrel, never saw a raccoon, didn't see. So anyway, just exhausted, get back that night, and I tell Ralph what we're doing. And I go, what was that we were on? What was that mountain? Who was that? He goes, oh, that was that old company, John Mansville. That's a mountain of asbestos, don't you? That literally was the world's largest asbestos mine that me and Bill walked about 50 miles on that day. So anyway, long story short, we're going back to the airport and it's all done. And I just had to ask Bill. I go, Bill, you have all these moose legs. What? How do I not see one and you have this from all these harvesting? And he goes, oh, no, I just cut them off the ones that are dead on the side of the road to get hit by the car. I make jewelry out of them, so. But Ralph, it was so funny because we get back and not a day later, Ralph goes, hey, Bill called, said the Moose are back in town. Let's run back up there. Oh, thanks. But anyway, it's just an honor to be here. Your family's been a blessing. Janet, it's so fun. From the day I met her, she's been my beer fairy. Once a month, I get a case of Mick Ultra. Sometimes I get to see her. Sometimes she just sneaks it in and puts it on my desk. But once a month, she's been my beer fairy. But Janet, thank you for all, for everything. And wow, what an honor. And I can tell you right now, the Colorado Eagles is here only because of Ralph. Only. And it's not mine, it's Ralph's. And it's not ours, it's not Northern Colorado's, it's Ralph's. And it always will be, and it will always be endeared to him. It's been an honor. Thank you.
Anybody else like to come up and speak?
I'm going to try to get through this. I'm a big teddy bear on the inside, so. Remember meeting Ralph and going home, telling my dad. I'm like, Dad, just met the founder of the team, you know, the coach of the team. And I was talking about Ralph, and I was like, I never seen him play, but you know, he's like Ralph Backstrom, Montreal Canadiens, all these Stanley Cups. The guy could fly. He's like, you tell him he's the only guy that could skate through the team twice, you know, and miss the net. And so I couldn't wait to go back the next day and tell Ralphie that. And we laughed, and you know, that smile and that laugh, boy, do I miss that. There's two things I remember talking about with Ralphie. One would be toothpicks, because we both had this passion for the latest and greatest toothpick. And he'd be like, Ryan. Every time I said, he'd be, Ryan, you gotta bend your knees when you skate, right? And I'd be like, Ralph, I'm just not a great skater, right? And he'd be like, no, Ryan, not that. And we'd just laugh. And but most importantly, I gotta be honest, I thought about this day. In 2006, it's truly my honor to speak today. In 2006, my dad passed away while visiting down here. And Ralph and Janet came up to Calgary to speak at his service on behalf of the Colorado Eagles. So my love and admiration and respect for the Backstroms goes well beyond hockey. Something that meant the world, not just to me, but to my family. So thank you, and Janet, I just saw, you know, Carrie wanted you to know we love you, and we'll always be there for you, and we can't wait to visit in Nashville. Thank you.
My name is Anne, and I'm here representing my family from England, Ireland, and Wales. And I'm your Colorado Denver family, Joy, Jack, and Elizabeth. So deepest condolences and lots of love from your United Kingdom and Irish family, okay? So my two great memories of Ralph is came to my house for dinner. I didn't know him in the hockey world. And I had cooked this great big standing rib roast. And I remember Ralph going back for thirds. And I was so proud that he liked my rib roast. So then my niece was visiting, and we came up to Windsor and had dinner with Ralph and Janet and Diana. And afterwards, we went back for ice cream. And Janet asked Ralph to take the kids, my niece and her boyfriend, down to see his trophy room. And afterwards, my niece shared with me that Ralph after we left the restaurant, hung back and walked with the two youngsters and just had kind things to say. And when she went down to the basement afterwards, she told me she felt like she was standing in greatness, but also that Ralph was very humble. So, you know, I think as adults, the greatest gifts that we can give to children and young people is to teach them how to be humble and to teach them to have integrity. And that is what my niece got from Ralph. She said her visit with Ralph changed her life. So, we love you, all of you. Thank you.
Would anybody else like to speak? I am told that the Eagles fan service representatives have a sign on their desk that helps them remember an axiom that Ralph believed in and lived, because nice matters. So when a fan would call to complain about his or her hot dog being cold, or their beer being hot, or their music being too loud, or the fans being too silent, or anything that made their experience with the Eagles less than they had anticipated, the fan service rep had a reminder to always be nice, because nice matters. So as we go out to our homes, our schools, our workplace, to our lives, let's remember to be nice to all we meet, have nice thoughts about all we think about, and in doing so, we can control our actions by controlling our actions, not by other people's actions. If you want to remember Ralph, that is a way to do it, because he was the nicest person you ever want to meet. Let us pray. Dear Lord, our God, we humbly entrust you with our beloved Ralph. We ask that you surround him with the fullness of peace and joy, with your Son and Holy Spirit forever and ever. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We hope that all of you will join the Backstrom family for lunch reception at Pelican Lakes Country Club in Water Valley. Not you. Hey,
thank all of y'all for coming.
There you go. There.
We appreciate all of you being here. One and a half. Our children. He loved them so. Thank you very much.
Service is over.
And spring became the summer.